Hello guys, I hope you're all doing fine during this pandemic crisis, and welcome to another video in which I'm going to talk about the oldest and at the same time I dare to say most progressive European civilization. This civilization or culture, as some scholars say, flourished on the European continent long before Rome and the ancient Greece, but also before the oldest known world civilizations such as Egypt, Assyria or Sumer in Mesopotamia, which are still considered a cradle of civilization according to official history books. In order to do so, I will split this story into two videos. In the first one, I'm going to explain two cultures that preceded and paved the way for the emergence of the cradle of European civilization. In the second one, I will try to explain why I consider Balkan Peninsula and Danube Valley a cradle of civilization instead of widely accepted idea of cradle of civilization being the Middle East. Let me start this video in a boring way with the definitions of civilization and culture. There is no clear distinction made by scholars and especially in mass media in terms of some society from the past being classified as a culture or as civilization. But according to some relevant available definitions, civilization is defined as a society with relatively high level of cultural and technological development, or more specifically, a society at the stage of cultural development at which writing and the keeping of written records is attained. Remember this part about writing, we'll be back to it at some point. Our story begins in Europe with the earliest evidence of presence of modern humans being approximately 37,000 years old, belonging to a group of humans arrived Europe either through the Middle East and Turkey or even more likely through the steppes of Russia. However, these people did not leave any significant genetic trace on modern Europeans, indicating they might have been extinct. However, they met Neanderthals on the continent, a subspecies of ancient humans and excellent hunters who were living in Europe for about 400,000 years and went extinct with the arrival of these modern humans, after slowly being pushed to the edges of the continent. Neanderthals did leave some genetic trace, ranging from 1 to 4%, depending on the part of Europe. Anyway, to complete the genetic picture of modern Europeans, this is far from enough, and we need to introduce more recent story, the story about ingenious European hunter-gatherers, early European Neolithic farmers who were responsible for agricultural revolution, possibly arrived from Anatolia, and the story about the arrival of Indo-European people who brought the language that we speak today, as well as some technological innovations such as wheel. I will not stick to the genetic aspect of the European story, but rather I will try to give you a brief introduction in terms of way of life and artistic, cultural and technological achievements of three very important and super interesting cultures which all overlapped on the banks of the mighty Danube River on the territory near the common border of three modern European countries, Serbia, Romania and Bulgaria. All the three cultures, out of which the third one practically can be considered a civilization, which we will discuss, tells us the story about mentioned groups which together make the DNA of modern Europeans. Let's begin with year 9600 BC. This was the time when the last glacial period finally ended, and after tens of thousands of years of constant extreme weather conditions, persistent snow and the ice cap covering almost all of Europe, climate finally started to slowly open the way for the emergence of first developed human societies. In still harsh climate, especially during the winters, the emergence of first permanent settlements, which is prerequisite for civilization, a naturally protected place was needed, or microclimate, possibly with lots of sources of food and decent communications, which was back then possible only in areas near rivers. All of that can be found in Djerdap Gorge in the northern part of Balkan Peninsula, on the border shared between modern-day Serbia and Romania. This gorge enabled the rise of so-called Lepenski vir or Lepena Virpul culture. Lepenski vir is one of the largest and most significant Mesolithic and Neolithic archaeological sites in Europe, and it is actually a small fishing place founded by ingenious European hunter-gatherers. The site itself, after which the whole culture carries its name, is located on the right bank of the Danube River. The site was discovered in 1960, and excavations, which were performed in several phases, started in 1965 and ended in 1971, when, what is interesting, the whole site was relocated for some 30 meters or 97 feet higher in order to avoid flooding from the newly formed artificial Djerdap Lake, created by the construction of the Iron Gate 1 hydroelectric power station. Archaeologist Dragoslav Srejovic, who was the first to explore the site, said that the monumental sculptures that were found there so early in human history with its original architectural solutions define Lepenski vir as the specific and very early phase in the development of prehistoric culture in Europe. The site is noted for its level of preservation and the overall exceptional quality of the artifacts. Due to the fact that the settlement was a permanent and planned one with organized human life, architect Hristivoj Pavlovic labeled Lepenski Lepenskivir as the first city in Europe. Lepenskivir's oldest findings date to 9500 BC and the youngest one dates to approximately 5500 BC. All of the seven successive settlements that were found followed the shape of the underlying terrain, a horseshoe-shaped plateau. Settlements always faced the direction of the river because the river was the obvious focus of life for its inhabitants. The basic layout of the settlement consists of two separate wings and a wide empty central space which served as a village square or meeting place. The settlement is radially divided with numerous pathways, all leading to the edge of the river. Archaeological evidences from a tent structure to a house clearly show the transition of way of habitation. In total, 136 habitats or houses have been found, and all of them share a very distinct shape, built according to a complicated geometric pattern. Most of them were used as living houses, but some of them were also used for sacral purposes. The basis of a house was a circle segment of exactly 60 degrees constructed in the manner of an equatorial triangle. The tip of the trapezoid base is pointed into the direction of the local wind. The material used for the floors is the local limestone clay, which, when mixed with the animal dung and ash, hardens like concrete. Because of that, the floors are still in almost perfect condition. On the edges of the floors, there are remnants of the stone reinforcement which served as the carriers of the upper construction. The covering material was some easily degradable material or was similar to the surrounding clay, so it couldn't be distinguished during the excavations. The interior of each house includes a fireplace. The fireplaces are further expanded with stone block to create some kind of a small shrine in the back of the house. These shrines were always decorated with sculptures carved from a massive round river stones and represent perhaps river gods or ancestors. Another significant feature of the houses is a shallow circular depression in the ground placed precisely in the exact middle, which might serve as some kind of an altar. The Lepenskivir sculptures were carved from the round sandstone cobbles found on the river banks, and they can be separated into two distinct categories, one with simple geometric patterns and the other one representing humanoid figures. The latter are the most interesting. Only the head and face of the human figures were modeled realistically, with strong brow arches and elongated nose and a wide fish-like mouth. Hair, beard, arms and hands can be seen on some of the figures. The following fact about Lepenskivir culture is almost unbelievable. Namely, the first archaeoastronomical surveys that were conducted in 2014 and 2015 pointed out the possibility of significance of so-called double sunrise to the people of Lepenskivir, which occurs there during the summer solstice. Let me explain this in more detail. The volcanic hill, which is located near the settlement just across the Danube, has a rocky lump near the top and an inclination higher than the inclination of the apparent sun's orbit. The sun appears above that hill, then goes behind the lamp and reappears again after some time. As the axial tilt changed since the time of Lepena people, in order to check this possibility, a geospatial analysis was conducted using the GPS, which proved that the double sunrise occurred at the time of Lepenskivir culture and it was visible from the original location of Lepenskivir, as only the specific position of the sun during the winter or summer solstices was important to calculate the time as a reference point, which repeats after exactly 1 year. Authors Pavlovich and Bajic, who published the book The Sun of Lepenskivir in 2016, believe that Lepenians used this double sunrise as a basis of some kind of a solar calendar. We could speak about this culture for hours, but we need to move on. Around 5300 BC, the inhabitants of Lepenskivir experienced the so-called Neolithic Revolution, most likely as a result from genetic and cultural influx from Anatolia. This is the period that marks the beginning of the boreal, when the water level drops, the rivers settle, the fertile soil forms and the warm forests spread to Central Europe. In this period, the inhabitants of Lepenskivir, partially mixed with the newcomers and partially replaced by them, domesticated the first animals and started farming. This youngest stage in Lepenskivir, in a certain way, belongs to the culture Starchevo-Keresh-Krish, flourishing from 5300 to 4400 BC. The Starchevo-Keresh-Krish culture was spread throughout the Balkans and Central Europe, as its name signifies the three closely related cultures, Starchevo, Keresh and Krish culture, that mainly cover a large area of present-day Serbia, Southeast Hungary and Romania. The archaeological site of Starchevo was discovered in 1912, while the exploration, backed by an American archaeological expedition, begun in 1928. Audit excavations were conducted in 1969 and 1970 under the direction of Draga Garashanin and the New York City University. Starchovo culture brings the beginnings of permanent population settlements and agriculture, cultivation of wheat, barley and millet, as well as the livestock, sheep, goats and cattle, while hunting and fishing were less prevalent. The people of Starchovo lived in clay houses mainly along the large rivers Danube, Sava and Morava. The findings, which became representative for Neolithic cultures in this part of the world, consisted of remnants of settlements formed of shallow dugouts of ellipsoidal and circular shape, skeletons buried within settlements, tools, clay objects, figurines, altars, etc. However, these ceramic vessels of fine and rough craftsmanship were among the most numerous. Apart from the painted ceramic vessels of thin walls, decorated with net patterns, spirals, garlands, floral motifs, ridges and finger imprints, some other ceramic vessels, for the aesthetic effect or for some practical reasons, are intentionally made to look rough. This method, seemingly crude, is actually a reflection of sophistication and progression. Like with other Neolithic cultures, most tools were made of stone, bones and antlers. Flints, obsidians and quartzes were used to make blades, cutters, scrapers and drills. Axes and hatchets were made of sandstone, limestone, granite, quartz and other rocks. Spoons, for example, were made of animal bones. Most houses were small, measuring approximately 30 to 60 square meters. They were built on a single story, which consisted of a single room without any internal divisions. Some structures may even have contained a loft on the second floor, probably used as a granary. What is interesting is that very few graves were found in the Starchovo culture, possibly indicating the cremation of the deceased. To be more interesting, most of identified graves belonged to women or children who were placed in the graves in a fetus position. They were inhumed under the floors of personal residences. This might give us an insight into the system of beliefs of these people, who possibly may invented the concept of human soul. Cremation most likely was the way to purify the soul and prepare it for the afterlife, free from the sinful body, while this was not needed for pregnant women and young children whose soul was still pure. Starchovo culture covered sizable area that included most of present-day Serbia, but also Montenegro and parts of Bosnia and Herzegovina, Bulgaria, Croatia, Hungary, North Macedonia and Romania. With the new wave of Anatolian newcomers, this culture was slowly replaced by the Vinča culture, which will introduce the world with various styles of highly artistic figurines as a hallmarks of the culture, but also with the Vinča symbols, the earliest form of proto-writing, and although not conventionally being considered part of the Copper Age, the Vinča culture provides the earliest known example of copper metallurgy in the world. All of this will be explained in high detail in the second part of this video. Thanks for watching and stay tuned.